If it is your will that we fight today, I am ready, Lord, thy will be done. It is your sword I will wield into battle. Your banner I will raise against those who would desecrate our land. And if it is my time to be with you, Lord, then I come to you with all the joy in my heart.
Thomas Jackson, growing up in western rural, very rural western Virginia, he comes to West Point with carrying the baggage of someone who is of a very low social strata. I mean, he's not an aristocrat by any means. There's a self-consciousness about that. The fact that he even gets into West Point in the first place is extraordinary.
Thomas Jackson, upon entering West Point, found a very different world from anything he had known before throughout his life. Orphaned by the time he was age 7, growing up in households of family members, Jackson looking for structure, perhaps, or being denied structure. At West Point, he certainly found that.
In 1842, the United States Military Academy was the finest engineering school in the Western Hemisphere. One had to be fairly competent, academically speaking, to get through. Jackson was totally unprepared for this. He had not been a great student. He had not had an opportunity to be a good student. So he went to West Point with very little to carry him through. And yet it was largely determination, a skill at mathematics, and impeccable behavior that got him all the way through West Point.
Upon graduating, of course, Jackson becomes an artillery officer and pursues that as his intended career through the Mexican War.
Jackson in Mexico is a wonderful story because this is the first time this young man, right out of West Point, discovers that he is a natural soldier. And in fact, not only does he discover it, everybody around him discovers it. It's his commander, Winfield Scott, Robert E. Lee, who is on Scott's staff and is the head of the engineers in Mexico. Lee's first meeting with Jackson is very interesting because Lee sees something in this young man. Jackson is an artillery lieutenant, has one battery under his command. And Lee sees that this man clearly knows something about guns and clearly is anxious to begin using them. And when Jackson finally does have the opportunity in Mexico to use his cannon, to take them into action against the enemy, it's an extraordinary story. It's a wonderful story. He's a hero. He almost single-handedly duels with a Mexican artillery battery and wins the day. And everybody in the army at that time, it's a small army, but everyone in the army at that time knows who Thomas Jackson is by the end of that time.
He was seeking a religious home from the time he graduated from West Point. In the post-war years in Mexico City, one day he actually went to the cathedral in Mexico City and knocked on the door and asked to see the head man. And in essence asked him, tell me something about the Catholic Church. That would be comparable today to ask the Pope to tell you in 50 words or less what Catholics believe.
I think it was typical of Jackson to go sort of to the top and to find someone who could speak knowledgeably with him. And clearly he was part of his own personal exploration.
He was not impressed by the Catholic Church. He thought the formalism, the pretentiousness and what of it did not appeal to him.
The idea that the Pope is the middleman between Jackson himself and God, and that's not a relationship that he's comfortable with. He needs to find more of what God means to him. And the Catholic religion really won't do that for him.
And it would not be until 1851 when he left the army and went to the Virginia Military Institute to teach that he suddenly found his home. And once he found it, it was overwhelming.
Upon Jackson's arrival in the little hamlet of Lexington, Virginia, in the Shenandoah Valley, it became apparent to him that the predominant religious following was Presbyterianism. The community had been established 80 years earlier by Scots-Irish Presbyterians coming into this part of Virginia. Jackson found himself surrounded by those people and their somewhat straight-laced, stiff-collared beliefs. This, in fact, appealed to Jackson. This man who was seeking order and structure throughout his life found a comfortable home in the Presbyterian church there.
Jackson liked, first of all, the informality of the service. Everyone was equal in the Presbyterian service. It wasn't a Catholic-like procession coming in where you look up to people who are obviously superior to you. It was more of a common ground religion, which he liked. The tenet of Presbyterianism then, I think, that most pleased him was the theory of predestination, namely that God has already ordained when you will die. And so Jackson could now go out and live life without fear of death. One has to remember that death was his most constant companion.
Thomas Jackson and his first wife, Ellie, are only married for a short time. She becomes pregnant, and during the birth of the child, she dies along with the infant. It's an absolutely stunning tragedy to Jackson, to everyone around him, everyone in the family. It is probably, to that point, the single most horrible moment in his life since the death of his mother when he was only 7 years old. It's something that scars him and I think stays with him for the rest of his life and very much has an impact on how he relates to God, how he sees the role of religion in his life.
Everyone he tried to love died. And so death, walking beside him so constantly, made him naturally fearful of his own future. But with Presbyterianism, he could forget that.
During the Civil War, Jackson is living the life of an Old Testament warrior, not really caring about his self. But knowing that he, as long as he's a soldier of the army of the living God, as he literally referred to his troops, that God would take care of the ultimate outcome. Jackson would admonish certain soldiers on the fields not to flinch if the bullets were flying in their direction, because it's of no value, it's of no use to do that. God has determined whether that bullet's going to hit you or not. That gave Jackson this sense and appearance to the rest of his soldiers, great courage on the battlefield, because the ultimate destiny, the ultimate outcome of any given battle, or indeed the war itself, had already been determined. And if Jackson were to survive, then God knew that and would make it obvious in time. If he were not to survive, then God would reveal that in his own time too. So this took all of the worry of the immediate moment off of Jackson's soldiers and off of Jackson personally, and allowed him to be perhaps a little more audacious and demonstrate courage on the battlefield that would not have been possible otherwise.
This may sound redundant in our age, but he honestly considered the Ten Commandments to be holy, and he was especially reverent where the Fourth Commandment was, "Thou shalt keep the Sabbath holy." On Sundays, he would not read a newspaper. He would not talk about secular things. He would not even mail a letter after Thursday for fear that it might be intransient on the Lord's Day and thus be disrespectful. So Sunday was the Lord's Day. Now this gets interesting when Jackson goes off to war, because in his first two or three battles were fought on Sunday, which went totally against the Lord's way, except that Jackson, as an army commander, realized what he can do one way, he can do another, and he would just simply issue a decree. So when you served under Jackson, you had to watch out for orders from headquarters, because the weeks went differently. You might have Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Sunday, Friday, or Wednesday, Thursday, Sunday, Saturday. You never quite knew, but someday in that week was going to be the Lord's Day, and you would stop and meditate and give thanks to God for the blessings that you enjoyed.
Well, there's no doubt that Jackson was a deeply religious man. I think it's important also to remember that he was a religious man in a deeply religious time. It's in our very secular modern age, it's really almost impossible for us to comprehend how totally saturated people's daily lives were by religion.
When the war ultimately divides the country, many pointed to the fact that it was because of the turning away from God of certain aspects, certain elements of the country. A more secular North being driven by an industrialization, the South clinging to more traditional characteristics of religious commitment. Jackson commented to a friend that he felt that God was unhappy with the South in general and would bring about war to correct certain shortcomings of the South. Jackson's role in that would simply be to do his duty as he saw it as a Christian.
Jackson knows, or at least has that sense, that God is looking over his shoulder, and that if he doesn't please God every day, whether it's at home or on the battlefield, he might be punished for it.
Jackson's faith was infectious. It was contagious. He did not push it on his men, but they saw him, and they saw him exhibit the faith. You know, they tell a wonderful story of Richard Ewell at the outset of the 1860 campaign. General Ewell was Jackson's second in command. He was, at best, an agnostic. And then as Jackson moved from victory to victory to victory, Ewell just wondered and kept watching Jackson give thanks to God. And at the height of the campaign or at the end of the campaign, Ewell went to Jackson's tent to congratulate him. And that was Jackson on his knees giving thanks to God. And Ewell is supposed to have said, "My God, if that's religion, I've got to have it." We Americans may not be unique, but we certainly are the champions of commercializing our past. We've done that to Jackson. We've named bubble gum after him, we've named stores, we've named counties after him, we've named all kinds of things after him. So we've reached the living end where we've just simply taken him totally out of kilter. When we have our heroes, we have to put them into our own environment to make them living beings. They become part of our pop culture. Men like Jackson would never have been part of a pop culture, but they have to be for us to understand them. And hence, we twist their reputations a little bit. We elevate them perhaps too high. Sometimes we may relegate them too low, but they become a part of the American pantheon for good or evil. And I think only in America do we take it to the extremes that we do.
Jackson's religious conviction and his religious fervor and his sort of moral rectitude made it easier to hold him up as an admirable figure than if he had been a swearing, you know, dissolute kind of individual. He became, I think, over time more of a moral paragon.
Historians will tell you that when a man dies has a lot to do with his place in history. And that Jackson died at the very height of his career. He was the most brilliant soldier in the Civil War by May 1863, perhaps the most esteemed soldier on earth at that time. So he dies at the very instance of his greatest fame. His loss is the most profound personal loss that the Southern Confederacy would suffer during the war. So his death at the midway point, and the fact that after Jackson's death, things went down. Now that may be coincidence, it may not be. Nevertheless, these two things combined to make him the great icon of the Confederacy.
I think when we look back at Stonewall Jackson, it's important to remember that he's really the first great hero of the South.
Once Jackson left this earth, everything he seemed to touch became holy. Anna Jackson, for example, never considered marriage again. She was quite content to be the widow of the Confederacy, and she lived well into the 20th century. Recalling what she had been with Jackson, the great wife, the loving mother, the association she had had with this inestimable warrior. Jackson's arm, which was amputated at Chancellorsville, was removed from the pile of amputated limbs, and it was buried with glory just outside the field hospital at Wilderness Tavern. It remains there today, and it's a sacred place for nothing more than an arm.
The man has left us a legacy. You don't have to be a Confederate, you don't have to be a Southerner, but to feel the power that this man exerted over an entire culture, over an entire people, and an entire war, it's still there today.